So we're talking about vignettes as well, TestVat, which is a package, Travis CI, and this combo that's really nice, package down plus amplify to improve your documentation. All right, so start with the motivation. I'm gonna start with a classical, statistical, inferential situation. I figured if we put the thanks at the end, we'd forget to do them or just go through them too quickly, so I'm gonna put them up front. There are lots of people who have contributed to this package, including some folks in academia, some people also in data camp like Nick Solomon, and some people in the room here, including, thanks again, Tim, for the projection help. All right, so yeah, this first example has to do with gender discrimination. Let me give you this setup for this study. This was an actual study, it's written up. It's now like 40 years old, but it's still kind of an interesting data set. They got 48 male supervisors at banks, and to each one they gave a single CV. And these CVs were identical across the 48 male supervisors. And they were just asked the question, do you want to promote this person, yes or no? The twist here is that, right, those CVs, they're identical except for the gender of the name on the CV, or at least the gender that most people describe for those names. So they picked fairly unambiguous names. And that assignment of CVs with male names or CVs with female names was done randomly to the supervisors. The question that the researchers were trying to answer was, are females being unfairly discriminated against everything else being equal with regards to promotion decisions? All right, so this data, we'll have up this bit.ly link later. There will be a play along section here. I'm gonna bring down the data set. It's called Bank Study. And if I glimpse it, I see that there's just two variables. There's gender and promote. And we have 48 observations. So those are the 48 bank supervisors, really, that were given a CV that corresponds to a female or male name, and then asked whether or not they promote, will promote this person. They'll say yes or no. All right, so we see there are those two columns of factors. If we want to do some exploratory data analysis, we could think about making a plot. We could use ggplot and make a, this will do a stacked bar chart. It looks like that. So it's a little fuzzy, but this is the bar corresponding to the male applications and the female applications. And you can see that the males were, in our data set, promoted at a much higher rate than the females. If we want to put some numbers on that, we could compute those two promotion proportions, or we could just cross-tabulate. So this is, if you're used to BASAR, this is when you would have used the table function. If you're using tidyverse syntax now, you can count the number of observations that are in each subcategory of gender, cross, and promote, and you learn this. And here you can see that, yeah, within the males, almost all of them got promoted versus within the females, just a little bit more than half did. So two different ways to look at this. All right, so that's the first example. We'll come back to it in a second. The second example data set is about drugs and response times. There's only 12 observations in this data set. We have 12 subjects that were randomly assigned to one of two groups. One of those groups is the treatment group. They're given a new drug. And the other six are in a control group. They're given a placebo. And actually, I don't know the details of what the drug was trying to do, but I do know that the response that they were trying to measure was reaction time to some stimulus, measured in milliseconds. Okay. So what we're trying to figure out is, does this drug versus the placebo affect the reaction time as measured in milliseconds? All right, so we can pull that data in, glimpse it, it's called drug study, and we see that, yeah, for each observation, each one of those 12 people, we've noted which group are you in, and what was your response? What was your response time? If we want to visualize that, we could use geom dot plot. Has anybody ever used geom dot plot? One of the more arcane geoms in the ggplot world. But it's useful when you have really small data sets. So you can actually observe here, each one of the 12 participants is a different dot, and we're just lining them up against their response time and color coding them. We can see that the people that had placebos had slow response times, people in treatment group faster, maybe it's, I don't know, caffeine pills or something. Okay, so yeah, I mean, we look at this, and that's pretty convincing that there's a separation between these two groups. If we want to compute some statistics, we could compute the two averages. So the average response time of the people in the treatment group, average of people in the control group, we get those two numbers there, 89, about 90 and about 100. So there's some difference in the means. Okay, so I guess I've introduced you at this point to two small data sets. We've done some exploration, and now's the time to do some inference. So we can phrase, we can ask the following two inferential questions. The first is, does this constitute convincing evidence that there's discrimination based on gender? The second one is this convincing evidence that drug affects response times? So at this point, if you have a computer, this is a bit where we'll give you maybe 5 minutes or so to play along. I'd like you to download these data sets. The difficulty of this task is will be determined probably by how long ago it was that you took your intro stats class. So if it was a very long time ago and you have no idea, you can always just do some exploration of the data or maybe find somebody near you that has taken statistics more recently. So take maybe 5 minutes with that, and we'll check back in.
And I highly encourage you to just do something during this time. Okay, so this is your chance to learn. So just hop on with somebody, chat a little bit, get going with some statistical analysis.
Oh, I see.
Right.
Any questions? Anybody stuck?
Okay.
able to get in the data set?
Yeah, I got the data.
Okay, good.
Just trying to think of something useful to do with it because it's set up just right for the infer package and then you want me to go ahead.
So which type of analysis is the first question? Maybe we'll give you a hint as you all proceed. Is it a t-test or ANOVA or chi-square test, difference in proportions? What kind of test is this? Yeah, so if you're running a t-dot test now, you're just like all of our intro stats students. And that's not a big problem, but t-test only work on numerical response variables, okay? So we have a categorical variable here, so you could do difference in proportions or you could do a chi-square test here. So that's the first one. Yes?
Could you do a t-test based on the mean promoted?
Sorry, on the mean what?
Promoted. So if you had a 40% females were promoted and 8%
You can do a difference in proportions test. Yeah. So whatever the what were those two proportions like 83 and 57? You wouldn't use t-test for that. You'd use probably a binomial test or a z-test for that. Very similar. Yeah. One thing that somebody figured out is if you're having problems loading these data sets in, there's a package called curl. And if you replace URL here, you load in the package curl, and then you replace the function URL with C URL, that may work.
Or just go to the browser, download the R data file, and then load that R data file into R. Either one works.
All right. So it turns out with actually both of these, if you're trying to figure out, like, gosh, what is the statistical method I'm supposed to use to answer this question, there is actually several statistical tests that would be reasonable in both of these settings. So we're just going to talk about maybe the two most commonly gone to in these situations. All right, so it might not leap out when you see the data presented this way, but usually if you see data that's presented in a 2x2 table that is a table of counts, like 2x2 contingency table, most people will run that into a chi-square test of independence. Maybe you knew that there was this chi-square test function in R, but you're like, I have no idea. How does it work again? What are its inputs? What are its outputs? You could bring up the help file here, and this is what you've learned. It can perform chi-square contingency table tests and goodness of fit tests. That's also called a chi-square test of independence. So what we want to do is that chi-square test of independence to figure out is our promotion decisions independent of gender. But how do we send our data there? It says, okay, first arguments are x and y. X should be a numeric vector or matrix. X and y can both be factors. Okay, you don't have to have a y, but if you do have a y, it could be a numeric vector. Ignored if x is a matrix. So there's a couple different specifications we can use here, and it's actually not even that clear what is meant by that. But I know from experience that by matrix they mean that cross tabulation, that 2x2 contingency table. So I'm going to go ahead and do that using the base R function table. I'm going to use the $ operator to pull out each of the columns, cross-tabulate them into this 2x2 tab table, and I can just send that to this chi-squared test function, and it gives me out the chi-squared test statistic, the parameter, and a p-value. All right, so does anybody want to take a huge risk
here and try to explain to everybody how are we supposed to interpret a p-value. Yes. Brave. Thank you for trying. So, having spent way too much time with p-values over the last 10 years, I have to be very careful in going through it myself because it's really convoluted what a p-value is as a measure. What people really want it to be is the probability of one idea or another idea being true or false. It's not that. It's you start a hypothesis test assuming some particular model for the world. In this case, we started this saying, all right, they're completely independent of one another. Okay, if they're completely independent of one another, what is the probability of getting the statistic that we got? In this case, a chi-squared statistic of 3.8. And it's telling us, well, probability of getting that or more extreme is this. And the idea, the mode here is if you have this be too small probability, you have two options. Either you just witnessed a miracle, something that's very improbable, or your null hypothesis was actually not correct. So you throw it out. All right, so this is right on the edge. So I'm not comfortable making any binary decision about the presence of discrimination in this case. 0.05 often is that arbitrary threshold that people use, but we can see we're just sitting right there on top of the threshold. All right. One thing I just want to point out here, so it used to be, well, most people do a chi-square test in R this way. They run chi-square.test, they throw in a contingency table, and they get out an object of class H test, which actually I didn't even know existed until I was putting together these slides. If you ask the class for this thing that comes out here, you learn that it's class H test. All right. So let's that in mind, but let's move on to the second question. All right, so this is a classic setting for a t-test. A t-test is when you have a small sample and you're trying to compare, make some sort of statement about means. So working with numerical data. If we pull up this help file, we learn, okay, this is student's t-test. It performs one and two sample t-tests, that's nice, on vectors of data. All right, here down at the arguments, we still have x and y. Y is optional. In this case, we have two samples. We have, drug, implicit, treatment and control. So we're going to give both an x and a y. X needs to be a numeric vector of data values. Y is an optional, non-empty numeric vector of data values. So can anybody tell me what it wants me to put in x and what it wants me to put in y in terms of this data frame that we have drug study?
I can tell you, you should use Google.
Yeah, there are examples at the bottom of the help file, but they're less helpful than you get on Google, that's for sure.
So that they end up in independent variables?
No. Frustratingly not. What it actually wants is it's X, it wants all of the response times of one of the groups, and the Y wants all of the response times of the other group. So this is kind of weird. So if we look at our data set, all of the response times live in a single column. So this data is data in a very nice structure. This is called tidy data. And it essentially wants us to untidy it before sending it to t-test. It wants us to break apart into two columns these response times. So I'm going to do that using very hacky base R. This is saying, take this column of times and keep only those where the group is equal to control, save that as G1, and then take that same vector but only keep the ones that are treatment, call that G2. Now I have two independent vectors, both response times, and I can send them into t-test, and something about Welch, so it's not just a vanilla t-test, it's a slight variant, but we get a very low p-value, and this is, it kind of gives you some extra printout information, it gives you 95% confidence interval. But I guess the way that you would interpret this is if in fact those two groups, the response, the treatment and control response times, share the exact same mean, then observing that difference in the two that we did observe would be really, really improbable. So we're going to throw out the idea that in reality, these in the populations, that these two means are the same. So if you're the drug researcher, this is making you very happy. So this will be done. All right, but to ask that same question, oh yeah?
The Bose name, how much
was
the tilde? Yeah. Can you repeat the question?
Okay, so there's several ways to specify that, but I guess under this specification, we're taking two vectors as input, and we're, again, getting this H-test object out. All right, okay, so I guess with those examples to reference, I want to talk about the two inspirations for the design of this infer package that's meant to basically provide an alternate way to do what we just did. One is the tidyverse design framework, and the other is, it's actually a blog post called There's Only One Test. Okay, so the Tidy Tools Manifesto, it's really interesting. It was written by Hadley Wickham. That's the link that should have been bibliophied, I guess. But if you just search Tidy Tools Manifesto, you'll find it. And this is the design framework that all of the packages that are in the tidyverse, so dplyr, ggplot, forecats, burr, all these, follow this design framework. The first is to reuse existing data structures. So that means use vectors, use matrices, use data frames, or tibbles, slight modifications of data frames. Another is to compose simple functions together with a pipe. The idea there is to have code that's more legible and breaking down a function into really one function that's only doing one thing. Third is to embrace functional programming. This really came into fruition with the PER package, which replaces for loops with function calls. And then finally to design for humans. And part of this is just making the functions verbs that are describing the operation that's happening on the arguments that you're putting in. Okay, so we want it to be able to do inference in this sort of framework, not just because we think it's a good design framework, but if you're working with ggplot, if you're working with dplyr, it'd be nice to kind of seamlessly move into this inferential framework. All right, the second inspiration is this blog post back in 2011. Alan Downey, he's a computer scientist at Olin School in Olin College in Boston, and it's a nice blog post. There's only one test. I just want to read the bottom here. One of the most common questions I see is something like, I have some data. Which test should I use? When I see this question, I always have two thoughts. One, I hate the way statistics is taught because it gives students the impression that hypothesis testing is all about choosing the right test. And if you get it wrong, the statistic wonks will yell at you, which is true. And Two is that there is only one test. So what did he mean by there's only one test? Well, he gave an image for what he's talking about, and this is it. So let me see if I can explain it. Again, Alan Downey, he is a computer scientist. He's not a statistician by training. So when he's trying to, when he's thinking through that how to analyze that 2x2 table of promote, not promote, male or female, he's thinking about a computational technique, not a mathematical technique, like the chi-squared test. All right, so let me see if I can get this right. He says that essentially any test can be boiled down to you starting with some model, your null hypothesis, and most times that null hypothesis will be sufficiently descriptive to describe some process by which to simulate some data. So you make a null hypothesis, then you can generate as much data as you want to. Now for each one of those data sets that you create under the null hypothesis, you can create some test statistic. And that test statistic should be informative about the question that you're answering. So maybe for, well, we could still do a promotion example. Chi-squared is less obviously intuitive, but we could swap it out with computing the difference in proportions. So if we were able to generate lots of synthetic data sets under a null hypothesis of independence, what we want to do next is calculate the difference in proportions for each of those. And the distribution of those statistics, that's what's called the sampling distribution. And that gives us a sense of the sort of statistics that you would see in a world where your null hypothesis was true. And the last step is just to figure out, all right, what was the statistic that I actually measured on my data, and is it in the center of that distribution, or is it in the tails of the distribution? And if it's far into the tails, you're going to get a low p-value. And so that, and it's a really, it's an elegant framework that can actually describe a huge proportion of the common statistical tests that are used. To me, it's much more intuitive, and the idea is, like if you're teaching this stuff, or if you're a practitioner, you don't need to memorize exactly what is a Welch's t-test again, and what is a Mann-Whitney u-test. You just have to remember there's only one test, and then just trying to figure out, all right, what's the method that I'm used to simulate the data? What is the most informative test statistic? Okay, so this brings us to infer. Infer, the idea is that we wanted to implement classical common inferential techniques in a tidy, first-friendly framework that's expressive of the underlying procedure. So in this case, we wanted all our functions, most of our functions, to have data frame in, data frame out. Another is that you compose tests and intervals as well, confidence intervals, using pipes. That you unite computational and approximation methods. So both these permutation tests that Alan Downey was talking about, as well as the traditional approximation techniques. And also that reading a chain of infer code should basically describe to you how a hypothesis test works. So when you get to that point of trying to figure out what a p-value is, you can just essentially read back through your code and it tells you what a p-value is. Okay, so here's our version of that there's only one test diagram. You start with a data frame. The first step is to specify the columns of the data frame that you're interested in. So what's your response? If it's bivariate, what's your explanatory variable? The second step is to specify your null hypothesis. That's done in the hypothesize function. Next, that null hypothesis should be sufficient to generate as many different simulated data sets as you like. As if that null hypothesis, if that null hypothesis were true, that's done with the generate function. And then what we want to do is compute that statistic for each one of these simulated data sets. That's done with calculate. And then if we take that whole collection of statistics that we generated, we combine them, we look at their distribution using a visualize function. And then, you know, once we have this, this is kind of the most informative thing of a hypothesis test. It's telling you what sort of test statistics would you see if that null hypothesis were true. And then you can look at the statistic that you actually observed and say, all right, was that like totally ordinary according to the null hypothesis, or is it really weird? Is it way out in the tails? And the p-value, you know, it's measuring essentially just how much of, how many of the statistics that you generated are more extreme or more in the tails. So I just think about the p-value as a measure of the consistency between your data and your null hypothesis. And when the p-value is small, the two are inconsistent with one another. Nice thing about this framework and these, I mean, is that five functions? is that if instead you wanted to do a confidence interval, if you use bootstrapping, we do all of these steps in bootstrapping with the exception of that we're doing it under a hypothesis. So if we wanted to do a bootstrap interval on the difference in proportions, we're just going to be generating bootstrap data sets now from our original data set, and then for each of those, compute the difference in proportions and look at their bootstrap distribution from which we can get a good estimate of the uncertainty in our point estimate. All right. If you're not too familiar with bootstrapping or confidence intervals, they're not the main focus of this talk, but you can check out the infer package documentation. Okay, so now I'm just going to run through the examples, and then Jesper will take over. So these are those same two examples, but done in infer. So for a chi-squared test, you take the bank study data, you specify, we're using formula notation here. In formula notation, you can read this as, I'd like to specify that I'm modeling promote as a function of gender, or that this is my dependent variable and that's my independent variable. And I'm going to be working with proportions, so I have to indicate a proportion is the probability of a success, which is going to be, yes, you're promoted. I'm going to hypothesize a null hypothesis of independence that my response and explanatory variables are independent of one another. I'm going to generate 500 synthetic data sets through permutation. And for each one of those, calculate a difference in proportions. And I want it to be a proportion that, yes, we're promoted amongst males minus proportion that we're promoted amongst females. Yeah?
Isn't the ideal number of permutations a function of the data size?
I don't know. I have to think about that.
Why wouldn't it be automated?
We could add defaults, or a default that looks at default method that looks at the size of the data. We haven't gotten there yet. Right now, we just throw down five. I mean, your estimated p-value will get more accurate the more that you do here.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's hard to estimate how the accuracy is affected based on the number of repetitions because it's also a function of sample size.
Yeah. I mean, for most of these, with just... I think the relationship with sample size actually isn't that strong.
So if you ran this again, you'd get a different p-value. How different?
Yeah. I mean, there'll be less variability the more repetitions that you do. So if this is like a production number that you're doing, I would up it to a very large number. If this is kind of an exploratory, trying to understand what's going on, I would do however patient you are. Yeah. Okay, so the result of this chain is a data frame now, or a tibble, I guess. In each one of these is a difference in proportions under the null hypothesis of independence. So we can, we could actually pipe this right into, there is a visualized function that currently does have some functionality, so we could go straight there, or we could do that plot by hand. So that plot looks like this. This is a density plot of all of those differences in proportions. We see that if they're independent, they're centered at zero, but you know they might get up to like 0.3 or negative 0.3. And if we wanted to figure out, okay, where was our data? Where was our observed difference in proportions in the context of this distribution? We can, this is the dplyr approach, to compute that difference in proportions v-hat. Then we can redo that plot by adding a v-line, a vertical line, where that statistic was. Oh, no, it doesn't come up. Okay. Well.
Okay.
It's about right here. yeah? To generate the data, yeah. So in this case, we're working with proportions. So you know, the standard deviation is just a function of the proportion. If we were working with, sorry, yeah, because it's all categorical data. So it's a function of the proportion of successes. So it's, yeah, but I guess if you're computing, so in this step here, what we're doing is we're effectively converting it to a true-false for newly random variable, and that if that category was yes, we're going to give it a 1. If it's not, we're going to give it a 0. And for newly random variable, its expected value is p, and its standard deviation is what, p times 1 minus p?
Square root.
Square root. And, yeah. So that's...
I think the question is, through the process of computing, you are shifting that data around, right? And each time you compute, you shift that data around, and then you take your groups and you calculate a new statistic for each one of those groups and take a difference, that gives you one little data point, right? And you do that over and over and over again. You do that 500 times, you have 500 data points. In those 500 data points, you get a standard deviation. That's a rough estimate of what the actual standard error is.
Right, right. I'm just wondering about what is the hypothesis, like what are you using to generate the data?
The null hypothesis. So you're asking what the null hypothesis is in this case?
Like, how do you, because when you're doing those random permutations, usually you get, well, if it was a continuous variable, you would give a standard deviation to random.
So I think, I guess,
it's based on the proportions that you observe in the sample. So you're basically, your parameters are the proportions of, and I'm probably going to explain this badly. So the proportions of yes and no's that you observe in the sample. So you basically use those proportions as the parameters to generate a new data set. That makes sense. So it's going to have the same n, and it's going to have like the same proportions. And then
right.
You see
but under the null hypothesis, so you're assuming the null hypothesis might
be infinity. Yeah, that's right. We're assuming that both of the proportions are exactly the same. Not necessarily that they're 50-50, but we're assuming in the populations by which these two data sets come from, the group over here and the group over here have exactly the same populations. And then our permutation is just assuming that those are exactly the same. We can do a shuffling, and then that's the process that gets us that.
So the shuffling is not very.
Yeah, so I guess one way to think about this is, in the infer package, we use a couple different techniques to generate data. One class of tests uses our permutation tests, where it's really simply shuffling one of the columns to break a tie. So it's always a null hypothesis of independence that the distribution, if it's two groups that you're permuting, that the distribution of promotion in this case is the same between the two groups. There's another class of tests that the way that we generate is through simulation. And if we're simulating a numerical variable, then we'd have to give it more information. We'd have to give it a mean, we'd have to give it a standard deviation. So you see that, I think the test that gets closest to what you're getting at is the one sample test on a mean. We're generating under a fixed value for a mean of numerical variables requires some sort of specification of the variability.
Males,
we're not testing anything about the absolute parameter values of those two proportions, only that they're the same, that the difference between the two is zero. There are different sorts of tests that you could use where you're actually asserting values for that parameter, for each of those parameters, the two different promotion proportions, but this one doesn't do that. Maybe, can we hold that question and chat later? Okay. We're just permuting the data, so we're not.
Do you want to talk about?
So the total number of promotions stays the same. It's just a difference.
Exactly.
So
the way to think about this is like you have a deck of cards. You have so many red cards. You have so many black cards. Thank you. And you're gonna shuffle those up, assuming that both of the means are gonna be the same across the two groups, and then you shuffle them up. Calculate a mean for the same size that you had before. Calculate a mean for the same size you had before here. You take a difference in those two. Just like I said before, we're not making any assumptions other than the distribution of those two, or that the means of those two values in the population are exactly the same. By making that assumption, we can do that shuffling, get all those simulated values out, do the shuffling over and over again 500 times, and then we get a rough guess to what that distribution looks like. Lots of times people say that distribution is normally distributed. Then you assume it's normally distributed, you know what the standard deviation is. That's kind of where you're getting at. But behind the scenes, there's really this kind of computational aspect to get that distribution out. So it's just a kind of a different framework for getting to the exact same thing as what you're saying. So we're
there was a bias.
Yep.
And then you see how we shot and then you say, okay, so here, and then you see what that solution is.
Right.
And then you say, okay, where's our data lie? And then you say, okay, now we know how far it is.
So we're like we're pulling, we should probably stop here, but we're pretending like we're sampling from a population over and over again. But that population has this distinct property that those two proportions or two means either way are exactly the same. And we want to see where is what we actually saw in our data, where does that compare with this distribution that we see. Yeah. Okay. So we gotta move on, just so people want to know more, but we're happy to chat further. That's okay.
Okay, let's see. Okay, yeah, so we got, since we're running a little long, I'll just kind of do this, go through it myself, I guess. But we could use the same infer framework and the same permutation approach to answer that second question too, the one about response times and whether you were assigned to the drug treatment group or the control group. Okay, so this can be thought of as a permutation test on the difference in means. So in this case, there's no success that we need to specify, but we still need to specify that our response is time and our explanatory variable is group. This is going to be a permutation test again, which is a null hypothesis of independence. We're going to be generating our data through permutation, and then we're going to be calculating for each one of those generated data sets a difference in means. Yeah, so this is, you can picture the two columns of data, and if in fact the two variables are independent from one another, then the fact that this observation is right next to this observation is completely artificial. So you might as well just swap it with this one. And the question is, when you do that many, many times and you compute the difference in the means for both those groups, what sort of differences in means do you observe? And that's just kind of a tabular view of those differences in means. We can see some are positive, some are negative. Hopefully they're orbiting around zero. We can visualize them. It's a little bit shaky, this density plot. If we wanted to plot and see if it works this time, our observed statistic, there we go. So the statistic, our actual data, was pretty extreme if in fact These two variables were independent of one another. So we go to compute the p-value, or the proportion of the simulated statistics that were more extreme, it's going to be very low. It's 0.008 here. All right. So that's just two of many, many different inferential techniques and statistical tests that we have implemented or are hoping to implement in Infer. To give you a sense of what we're looking at, something that's maybe most interesting for practitioners is we're going to basically build wrapper functions. So, you know, if you're really a fan of brevity, the idea of having to write that much code to do a permutation test on two means, maybe that's unappealing. Originally, this package, one of the reasons for writing it was for teaching these techniques and for really understanding where a p-value comes from. And so this more verbose, expressive approach is appealing, but once you're a practitioner, it just does kind of get in the way. So we'll be writing these wrapper functions. So calculate, I don't know if you noticed, but when we're deciding, all right, we've generated all these data sets, what is the statistic that we want to calculate? We're specifying it as a string, a quoted string, which is a pretty crude way to do this sort of computation. Essentially, in the code, it's looking for that string and mashing it to a particular procedure. So what we're going to be changing is, for example, making this be a legal thing to do. So any arbitrary statistic that you can calculate of a data set as a function, allow that to be put in. So this will make it so that you can do permutation test on your favorite statistic. That will also allow us to support more advanced regression models. Right now, I think we have a single slope in the simple linear regression framework, but it's pretty rudimentary. Visualize right now does work, but there's lots of other bells and whistles that Chester's been working on that will soon be going in there, so that really it's, you get this really nice visualization of the sampling distribution and where your observation fits into that. One important thing here is lots of these tests essentially have a computational approach and a traditional classical mathematical approximation approach. And it can be really informative sometimes to compare the two. So hopefully we'll get to that with Visualize, where you can see, you know, the t-test based on the student t-distribution overlaid with the sampling distribution from the permutation test on the difference of two means. And finally, add something called list columns. So if you go through the infer code, once you get out of the generate step, if you were to break the pipe there and see what it spits out, you would see a very tall data frame, because essentially all that it's done is created lots of data sets. All the generated data sets are just stacked on top of each other in one tall data frame with a replicate column so that you can do kind of group-wise computations on them. Turns out that's pretty slow and memory intensive, and the map function in the per package is just designed for exactly this sort of structure, so we'll be adding that into the generator. It won't change the syntax, but it should speed up quite a bit. Okay, that's it for the main part of infer. Move on to part two?
Yes.
Okay, so this is more general notes on cool things that we've learned so far about how to build a package. There's just lots of really cool technologies out there right now to help do this.
Okay, so thank you all for hanging around so far. So, like Andrew said at the very beginning, this was really the first package we ever, well, it's not the first package I designed, but it's the first package that has lots of functionality, requires lots of tests, we're gonna have to send this to CRAN, they might be mean to us coming back, all that kind of stuff, right? So we were fully kind of thinking this is gonna be the case. So we tried to be, as much as possible, state of the art in trying to help us develop packages, make a good framework for developing packages and following through with that. So I want to showcase some of the things that I talked about here that will be links for you to check out. And I tried to include direct links to stuff on our GitHub,
where you can actually go look at our tests, for example, and then further documentation that we use for doing this sort of thing. It's a big whirlwind of stuff. For the last month or so, Andrew and I have been really pushing hard to get this to CRAN, so this has been my baby very recently. So obviously, Andrew and I are both working on this thing exactly at the same time, and so that's a huge problem potentially if we're overwriting each other's code. How many of you, nobody will say, if I say, how many of you don't use GitHub, you all will say, how many of you use GitHub? Okay, so that's a vast majority of you. It's pretty much changed the way I think about programming entirely. I don't know if you feel the same way. Even if I'm not even thinking about working with someone else, I still just, as much as possible, put myself on GitHub, because it's really easy, you can share things. It's a great way to do it. Actually, this is on the GitHub webpage, a better way to work together. That's like, what a fantastic little brand name motto that they have there. So that added the OctoCAD in there too. So GitHub additionally is really nice. Well, RStudio is really nice, but they added integration for GitHub right inside RStudio. So for a very, very long time, I didn't even know that you could type git space whatever. I was just going into RStudio and pulling down and clicking the little buttons, and I was pretending like I knew how to get uploads. Okay, and that's for most intents and purposes, that's exactly all you need to do. So RStudio integration is really slick. Another thing that's fantastic, and this is a very recent development, probably only in the last 6 months, I've been using pull requests a ton. So Andrew will submit some code. For it to go to master, we require a pull request with an actual check to make sure it works. So one of us can't just screw up the entire thing. It takes both of us to screw up the entire package if we want to. So pull requests allow you to go line by line and show you exactly the changes that have been made. It's a fantastic way to review code, really review text. It's a great way to go. Another thing that we started off doing was just using GitHub Pages to easily publish our web pages. So it's just a little thing in the settings. You check some boxes, and automatically, like that, you have a page on the internet if you set it up appropriately. So it's pretty slick. Okay, so I did link. This is actually the most recent pull request from our page, and there's a lot of really funny things in here, like blah, oy vey, enough is enough, and so there's a lot of things just going back and forth and trying to get this stuff to test out. So I think it's just fun to see this kind of stuff. And if you go further enough into the tidyverse on GitHub, you can see Abby Wickham's pull requests and the stuff that he does, and it's the same sort of thing. So if you're just getting started, don't worry about it. Like, it's okay, nobody's perfect, and it's a great way to get started. A couple of good resources I recommend if you want to get started on this. Have these R packages book is available for free. It's a little bit outdated, maybe a couple years, but it's still really good. Especially for the GitHub part, just showing you how to get started with RStudio, telling you all about GitHub, how to get it work. Happy Git with R is a book that Jenny Ryan is constantly updating and making really nice, and does a lot of troubleshooting. I pretty much just follow that whenever I get stuck and I can't figure out how to do something. Lots of great chapters there. Okay, so that's GitHub. Can't sing its praises enough. Another thing that we realized is as we looked over the t-test and we looked over the chi-square test and we looked at the examples at the bottom, we realized we should probably do a good job of making sure that users of ours can have examples they can follow and make sure that the output makes sense, all that kind of stuff. So as much as possible, we looked to create vignettes, and we actually kind of thought about vignette-driven development. So we pretty much put down all of the examples that we would like to be able to do, and then as we implemented each one of those things, we started adding them back into the vignettes, get the vignettes to run as the package run. So that was our initial kind of testing procedure. The DevTools package. Who knows about the DevTools package? Who only uses DevTools to install things from GitHub? That was me, like, very recently, like, just a few months ago. DevTools includes so much more than just being able to install from GitHub. You could submit the package to CRAN via the release function with DevTools, ask you some questions, submit some stuff. It's all also integrated into RStudio, so there's buttons set up, there's keyboard shortcuts, all this cool stuff. So if you're building packages, I highly recommend the DevTools package. And there's a build vignettes function right in DevTools that will build all of them for you. So one example of a vignette, this is on CRAN, like I said, version 0.1, right? Like Andrew said, 0.1.0 is on CRAN right now, so if you go search infer CRAN, it will come up. So you'll see a shameless, terrible thing that we did. We forgot to change the name of our vignettes. So we have two vignettes, and they both have the exact same name. But very soon, when we submit to CRED, that will be fixed. Okay, so there are little bug fixes there. But the flights example shows up twice. We have one flights examples, and don't judge us, but we have an empty cars example as well. Okay, that's a decent enough data set, so we went that way. So there's an example if you want to see how the vignettes can be helpful in analyzing and looking over how our stuff works. And then there's a link to Hadley's DevTools package with a lot of examples and all of the functions in the README there. Okay, you all are ready for more. I can just see it in your eyes. Give me more stuff. Okay, another thing, testing and assertions. So this is also a very recent development. We had no idea that this was actually a thing, I think. I'm sure it was a thing, but I didn't know how to do it. I had no clue how hard it was, anything like that. So when you think about all the packages that you worked with, probably some of them, you have no idea what the error messages are that you get back, right? It's a very frequent thing for me. I have to Google, I have no clue what's going on. So as much as possible, when you are doing things that we don't like in infer, that's not going to be a useful thing, we try to spit out a nice error message at least. So error messages in that form are kind of usually called assertions. You're checking to make sure that the users have inputted something appropriately. So we tried to put as much of that in there as we could. And you can go to this link right here, it goes to our GitHub for the specify.r file, and you can look to see how we use if and stop and the assertive package to kind of put some assertions into our code. Okay, also, what messages are provided for the user? Does the code actually work as you implement changes, all that sort of thing? So the test that package allows you to write tests that will run every single time you build the package. So it will check to make sure that you didn't break anything by including new implementations and everything is still working along the same way. Okay. So I have a colleague named Richie Cotton who would love it if you buy his book on testing R code like I did. It's a short little book, really nice in explaining what all this stuff is about.
It's really good.
Yeah, cool. Another thing, Travis CI. Who knows what Travis CI is?
Hey, Travis.
Hey, Travis. What does CI stand for? Continuous integration. So what does that mean? Are we going like back to calculus and just integrating over and over? No, we're not doing that, right? So this is, it's constantly checking, right? So one thing we realized is the package got bigger and bigger and bigger. Just running this stuff on our machine was really annoying, right? We would, okay, we implement some new stuff. Let's build that. Okay, now we got to wait for the build to finish, make sure everything goes through. So what Travis will do is it will automatically do those checks in the cloud for you. Okay, so you make changes, push to GitHub, and then Travis makes little checks to make sure that these things are working. So, do I need to build a package on my own machine every single time to make sure it works? Not necessarily, you can use Travis instead. It syncs nicely with GitHub, but what's even cooler is you can just have a pull request sitting there. Travis will see, oh, there's a pull request waiting to maybe get merged into master. I'm just gonna run the test on the pull request to make sure everything works. So before you even push it into master, if you're like, not for sure if the code is gonna work, Travis will just run all the checks for you. And then if it works, then you say, okay, I'm gonna merge it into master and my package is ready to go. So you can go, this is another awesome thing, Travis, you can actually just go look and see what all of our stuff has looked like. And the very recent frustrations are getting us all to work. Very similar URL, just travisci.org and then same as the GitHub there. So I provided nice resources for all of the other things. I don't know of great resources for Travis, especially not in the R side. So this, especially over the weekend, was a lot of me just like, I'm going to try this, and I'm going to wait for the build to go through. It didn't work. I'm going to try something else, and I'll wait for the build to go through. I'm going to try something else. So there are times when locally building would be really nice, right? So in an ideal world, when Travis goes through and everything works, it's fantastic, but there's not a ton of documentation out there. So proceed carefully, is what I usually say. The last step is PackageDown and Netlify. So who do you think wrote PackageDown? If you had to guess one person, who do you think would be the author that wrote that? Hadley Wickham. Okay, so Hadley Wickham created a package, an R package, that generates a web page for your package. All you have to do is run the build underscore site function. That's it. You just install PackageDown, it's sitting, you have the package ready to do whatever you want to do with it, you've been testing it, you just run PackageDown, library PackageDown, build underscore site, boom. And does a bunch of cool things behind the scene, and then poof, there's a web page. There it is. Okay. Remember the power of GitHub Pages. It automatically puts it into the right folder when you do this sort of thing, and then you submit that to GitHub, and then GitHub sees that the package is there and makes a nice little web page for you. Boom.
it's done. Okay? So more and more, like tidyverse.org is built with package. Okay? So anytime Hadley does stuff that he thinks is cool, he tries to put it into a package so that everybody else can use it. Awesome philosophy. It's really great.
It's magic.
It is. It really is magic. And it just works. I don't get weird little errors or anything. You just run the button and it goes through. But another annoying thing with this is we also didn't want to wait for package down to the build, right? So it takes a couple minutes, it's doing some stuff, it's running through all the vignettes. So the last thing I worked on this weekend was trying to get this synced up with Netlify and Travis. So I want Travis to do the package down stuff for me, and then Ron actually puts it in the right folder, does everything for me like that, so I don't have to actually do that locally. Another thing is Netlify. I'll have a link at the end. That would be a great use to you with Netlify. It also runs tests and it hosts pages in a nice way too. So instead of having very long .github.io/whatever, you can just have infer.netlify.com. Okay, that is actually a thing. That is our webpage for PackageHub. Okay, so through many trial and error, and getting the Travis set up appropriately. So this is the file in our repository that tells it exactly how to use PackageDown. Run through all the tests in the appropriate way. That file is there, so I encourage you to check it out. I have no idea if that's the optimal way to do this, so if you have a better way to do it, please let me know. This was me hacking as much as possible, trying to get it to work, and then it works, it's not. Okay, so infer is the package page, like I said. I'll give props to Allison, the blog down book. Netlify, they have a nice little spot in the book. It talks a lot more about Netlify and the power of it and why you should